G'day, Easy Esky here, out for another ride. Now that the restrictions of lockdown have eased up, I'm getting out on the bike more. Now, it is winter here in Australia, and of course on a bike, when you are exposed to just about everything, it can get cold. The motorcycle jeans that I'm wearing actually do a good job of insulating from the wind, and I've actually got a long sleeve top underneath the leather jacket, and of course I am making full use of my Oxford heated grips, really enjoying those as well. And if you're actually looking not just at the SV650 but at a bike that you're going to be riding for a length of time, I can wholeheartedly recommend heated grips as a modification to your machine. And the Oxfords are really good. The controls there, just on the other side of the left switch gear, stretch your thumb over, but usually you just preset it for the ride, and you might need to adjust it if you've turned it up. Like when you warm the bike up, you also warm up your grips and then you turn it down correspondingly. So where I am today is I actually decided there was a brand new bakery over at Bell's Line of Road in Bilpin that I had gone past a couple of times, and I couldn't help myself and I had to go check it out because there was always a crowd there. Now the trick for me is that I'd actually ridden past on a couple of Sundays, and I thought, if I come along Saturday morning, maybe it'll be quieter. That did not really turn out to be the case so much. Some of the shelves were empty. Now, the bakery, it's called the Angry Baker, has only been open for a couple of months. But some of the shelves were empty. Ordered a couple of sausage rolls. Very nice, very nice. Unusual size. They're almost about the size of half a standard pie. So they're really, really sort of stumpy and thick. And a very interesting sauce that goes with them. And one thing I would say, people did a lot to support, the fire brigade and other people in trouble. Something you can do for yourself if you're in Sydney is, hey, take a trip up to Bell's, stop at one of the businesses there and show your support. I can't speak to the quality of all of the business there, but the fact that there's always somebody stopping at many of these places, and they do seem to be coming back now with the lockdown restrictions reduced, is a very healthy indicator. The business that burned down, which was the Tutti Frutti, they've actually got a big sign just to say that they will return, and there is some sort of construction happening on site. So I've actually got some fond memories of stopping in there. They serve unusual flavors of ice cream, or maybe gelato, but you get the idea. Tasty. So if you look carefully at the road, you'll actually see, so this is about 1 o'clock, I'm on the return journey, and you'll actually see that in patches, the road is actually still damp. Which, of course, one of the thing was before I came, so I've come up, gone to Mount Victoria, over to Bell's on the Darling Causeway, and the first thing I did was actually turn west because I wanted to check out something in Clarence. Didn't find exactly what I was looking for, but it still was interesting because I'd actually not previously got off the highway there. Clarence is where you'll find the zigzag railway that unfortunately didn't open in 2019. Of course, they got sort of, knocked to their knees again with the fires over summer. But they do have, hopefully that they will be able to get back on their feet and reopen. It's certainly a very interesting attraction and is a sort of hearkening to yesteryear and you know, it's voluntary, and I've been on it a couple of times, and it's an exciting thing to do. So the one thing you'll note, of course, is you know, the devastation as I ride through these areas. You know, the bushfires come through here. Camera really, really doesn't pick it up all too well, but there are, in fact, there is actually some regrowth. So one of the interesting aspects of the trees in this condition is that you're actually not blocked by their foliage. Normally I would ride through here and it would just be, you know, a wall of trees on either side of the road. I can actually see, of course, you know, briefly and riding along on a motorcycle, some of the beautiful vesta through the trees that I normally wouldn't see, and of course once the growth returns, I won't see again. So this is why I've actually done this road a couple of times, is to actually you know, get the value out of the additional view, and of course as time marches on, you know, the regrowth will eventually cover it up. So the other interesting point about the section of road that I'll be coming into, it's one of the few 100 zones in the mountains areas. It's actually conditional. If it's raining, you can only do 80. But the road at that section is dry, and of course, you know, I'm cautious. The other thing that's happening for me in the video is that you will see, of course, the corner of the headlamp of the SV650. I actually mounted this down on the left indicator. I'd stopped on a place called Ghost Hill Road. It's amazing. It's got this massive signpost there, and I don't know why it deserves a massive signpost. There's not a lot in there. I think there is, like, there might be accommodation. Maybe eventually Bilpin has festivals and people want to come up and stay for that sort of thing, or just for the country air. It is a nice area. It's not as cold as, say, Belmount Vic, Blackheath can be. It is a little bit warmer, and of course, once you get further down the mountain, you're getting into a slightly better climb. And this was just a great ride. I was very happy to be out on the road again. I am certainly enjoying the SV650 as a machine. I'm sort of gotten used to, you know, riding the machine. I still hit the horn once or twice. It's just, I got all the way into Blackheath, went to switch lanes. It's like, oh, that's the horn. Yeah, ignore the horn. No one, no one, no one, no one. You didn't see anything. Move along. And it occasionally happens, and eventually that, I expect that problem to fade away as my muscle memory gets used to the switch gear and where the indicator is, and other appropriate things. So, of course, it being winter, I'm already plotting ahead and thinking, you know, hey, once it rolls around to spring, do I want to take some leave? Do I want to go on an adventure? And hearkening back to my earlier videos, the lesson that I learned is not to go too far. And I'm sort of looking at a range at around 250. So 250 will get me somewhere as far as, like, say, Singleton, because I do want to try the Putty Road. Now that I've got the SV650, it's a road to try. And the one thing I think I was checking was fuel stops. So the interesting point about the instrumentation on this motorcycle is it actually has a range option. And the range, of course, typically when I fill the tank, depending, can be ridiculously high. I'm not sure how the machine rates itself. I think the interesting point is that when I go down the mountain, because of course you know, you're mostly going downhill, using that, you're consuming less fuel, you get this ridiculous amount of range. It'll sometimes say, like, hey, if you keep traveling like this, you'll travel 300 kilometers, which is possibly true if I was continuing down, an impossible mountain, which of course Australia just doesn't have huge mountain heights. Bell is about the highest point you will get in the mountains. I think it's 1068. I'm not sure about Mount Toma, although that's not, that is Blue Mountains, but it's on Bell's, it's not on the Great Western. Blackheath is like 1065, which is why it gets a patch of snowfall once a year. But yeah, I was talking about the heights. So yeah, as spring rolls on, I was also thinking about maybe Cara, if I can. I got to do some research to see if they do something for the cherry blossoms. I sort of knew something about it last year, and didn't react, or reacted rather too late, and then I thought, no, fine, whatever. So I think if I plan it out, and Cowrie is another thing in reach. That's again another approximately 250 away from me. And the part of the reason for this is that I was trying to figure out how to maintain the bike if I go further, because after a certain distance, you need to first of all lubricate the chain. It has to be oiled. And I've sort of read stories from other adventurers who carry materials with them as a part of their trip. They'll actually carry some sort of spray-on lubricant, and I'm just thinking, is that something that I want to do, or is it something I just want to stick with at home? And basically, have the trip, bring the bike back, and then do servicing in a comfortable, familiar environment with all the tools on hand that I need to do the job. So, of course, I'm not doing a lot of maintenance. I'm still heavily reliant on the mechanic, and I'm actually happy with that setup. I know some people will really like to get in, get their hands on. Possibly if I was younger, when I was younger, I would actually service my own car. I was comfortable and with that sort of thing. But look, that motorbike, I'm happy that it gets done properly, that I don't stuff it up, or that my kitchen table isn't covered in engine bits or something. So, now, funny question I wanted to ask is, it's a cold day. It's about 9 degrees, but I'm still warm. I've taken precautions against being cold. And the road feels a lot more bumpier in the cold. So I don't know if that's a thing or it was just how I felt for the ride. But there was a few sections where, yeah, it just felt a lot more bumpier and a lot more uncomfortable to be on the road. So, maybe it's a con, although I wouldn't have thought, it's not like metal or something which will in fact expand and contract. You will actually see, if you look at sort of particular bridges, particularly the old iron bridges, they actually have the ability for expansion and contraction. There's actually a play of movement in their mechanism that allows it. But just for the general road, I wouldn't have thought that tar would actually change. It just felt like that. It was just an impression that I got. So, of course, just quickly getting back to the headlamp is, of course, you can see the headlamp in this thing, which is fine. I've actually put the video through iTunes to remove the shake. There was a lot of shake. Now, what I also done, and it doesn't really work that well, is that I've remounted the camera near the curbside passenger foot peg. And you get a lot of the back wheel, and then of course you can, the back wheel covers about a quarter of the picture. And then, of course, the rest of it is just the scenery going backwards. But it's not as comfortable to view, I feel. But maybe I'll just publish one just to see if there's a reaction from my viewers. But the other thing is that it's stable and still. So when I mounted it to, of course, the indicators are just like a rubber plastic mount, and you actually look at them while you're riding, and there's actually a lot of shake in them. So when I put the camera on it, I could actually see the camera shaking, and I first thought, well, is that gonna, I mean, yeah, these things obviously have to be robust. If they're action cameras, they've got to take tumbles and falls. Not so much drop, but people will ride them, on motorbikes or such as myself, or on bicycles and go over trails and bumps and ridges. So the camera obviously has to handle shake to a certain point, which this did, and camera's still running. But it's not handlebar mounted, so the handlebars are in the middle section, are actually below the instrumentation, so that actually blocks that mounting point. And eventually, I'm going to chase it up, is the handlebar mounted windscreen that was promised with the purchase of the motorbike. It was out of stock and is still out of stock, and of course, COVID doesn't help that stock replenish. But hey, it's been 3 months, so I'll get in touch with them again and say what gives and how's it going. But I felt really good about this ride. A couple of rides that I did, like I did a couple of rides at night, and winter at night, it's an unpleasant experience. So I quickly needed something in the major town. 10 kilometers there, 10 kilometers back. Well, it felt like riding through 20 kilometers. It was biting cold. Cold seemed to get into everywhere. And it was like, oh, I just want this over. This is not a pleasant experience at all. Just something that I have to get through. And that's, of course, not why I want to ride a bike. I ride it because it was a joy. And this trip brought back that feeling, those that warm and fuzzy. Hey, this is what it's about, and I am enjoying riding, and I'm enjoying riding at my own pace. So things are coming along nicely. Very soon, of course, middle of winter, we come to the solstice, the winter solstice, and but for upper mountains in New South Wales, usually it will get colder late July through August. So we're not sort of at colder sections yet. So about a month ago, we did have a Friday, snowfall brief. It just quickly melts once the sun came up. It's really good when the sun comes up and it's hangs around for a couple of days, then how cold it really is. So yeah, this was it was good, and it showed me that yes, I can ride in winter. I just got to work out how I pick the day, or how I pick the time, or whatever the conditions are, that it's not going to be too adverse, that it's not going to be unpleasant. Anyway, thanks for watching. You all stay safe, and look forward to you in my next vid.